I'm Leo Morris, editorial page editor of the News-Sentinel, and I'm interviewing Kathy Heuer, who's an incumbent and candidate for state representative, District 83. Hi, Kathy.
Hi, Leo.
We're starting out asking anybody running for the General Assembly this year to kind of rate the last session, what you thought was good, bad, could have been done better, shouldn't have been done, overall grade.
Well, I think we got a lot of major things done. I'm real excited about the dollars that are coming back to Allen County for transportation with the improvement of Lafayette Center Road. One thing that I don't think a lot of us were real comfortable with overall was the business personal property tax and what may happen to some of our locals as far as their revenue streams from that. But the compromise measure was to push that forward, so it really will not be implemented until the middle of next year.
And counties have the option, right?
And totally an option, but we'll also have the opportunity to do what the governor promised all the mayors in the Mayor's Association that he would do, is to find a replacement revenue stream. And that's, to me, the key piece of that part of the legislation.
The local option was kind of a theme this year, wasn't it? I mean, they gave Allen County the right to change the vote to change on government structure. Mm-hmm. Counties around Indianapolis are going to be able to vote on whether or not to finance mass transit expansion. All counties are going to be able to decide whether or not to drop the business tax.
I think that that's been one of the goals of us as a legislature for the last 4 years, is to make sure those options are out there and available, but the control is at the local level, not the state level.
Am I being too optimistic to hope that this might be the start of some momentum for home rule?
I think if the Republicans have anything to say about it, that's what we'd like to see, yes.
What do you think about the referendum here in Allen County? Do you think it's a good idea to change the structure of local government to take away a little bit of the commissioner's power and give a little more of it to the county council?
I really think that this is a great opportunity for the people in Allen County to take a solid look at it. The one piece of it that I was especially pleased with was the fact that we created 9 different council districts. And by doing that, I really believe that people who live in the more rural areas will have better representation. Right now, I think 3/4 or more of the county council members come from Fort Wayne. And the same is true with the commissioners. There will be much better representation if we know that every district will have their own representation.
And a commissioner, or whatever they call it, executive, would be more or less like a mayor, right? He would not really initiate anything, he would carry out whatever the council
does. Right, the legislative power would stay with the council.
Gay marriage fight. That took up a lot of time and created a lot of heat at the beginning, and then it kind of went away. I mean, by changing the wording, the General Assembly pushed the vote out at least a couple of years. What do you think about that?
Well, I voted for that measure as far as voting to take the second sentence out, but I voted against putting the entire amendment into the Constitution. Once I really dove into the Constitution, took a look at the framework of our government to see, you know, what's the Constitution really about? And not only does it delineate the fact that power should be limited for government, it also affirms the rights of people. So you look at affirming the rights of people, you look at limiting the powers of government, and I didn't see that that particular amendment fit with either of those two parts of the Constitution. I did not find that that was an agenda item for any particular group that I had been working with. 3 years ago, when I voted for that, I had over 85% of my constituency that wanted me to vote for it. This year, it flip-flopped, and I had over 52% of my constituency that wanted me to vote against it.
The turnaround on that issue has been remarkable. I think it's more than any issue in my lifetime, with the possible exception of the demonization of tobacco. I haven't seen public opinion shift that quickly. Isn't that remarkable?
It is, especially in my generation's lifetime, to see it that quickly changing. I had someone of the younger generation, I would put him probably in his late 20s, someone who holds political office, ask me what he thought the legislature was afraid of, not me in particular, but by making this decision, were we so afraid that their generation wasn't going to be capable of making those decisions down the road that we wanted to make sure that it got into the Constitution so that it would be so much harder to change? And I didn't have a good answer for him.
You think it might be that this has been put off not just for a couple of years, but forever since the vote? Four lawsuits have been filed challenging our law banning gay marriage. Do you get the sense that it might end up in the courts before it gets back to the General Assembly?
It could. It very easily could with what happened in Michigan this week.
Yeah.
I think everybody's taking a hard look.
And Utah. Yeah. And
ultimately, I think the courts will decide the entire issue, no matter what we do as a state.
Did you take some heat for that vote? Is that why you have a primary opponent?
I would assume so. I would assume so. The 912 group has come after me pretty hard.
But you didn't take the weather this morning.
I'm very optimistic about it. People that I have talked to are very supportive. I'm being endorsed by the Indiana Chamber of Commerce and several other organizations. I don't know where some of our local organizations are yet. They usually don't make their endorsements till a little bit later, but I just won the Workforce Legislator of the Year for Greater Fort Wayne Incorporated, so I'm hoping I'll have their support.
What did you work on this past session?
Mostly the skills gap. I mean, we've been trying to talk about jobs, do things to try to create a great environment for jobs, but over the past 4 years, the number of unemployed has not shifted very much. But the surprising part, the opposite side of that fact, is we have over 100,000 jobs open out there that we don't have skilled people to fill. So that was the nut I really wanted to crack this year, and I think we made some great strides.
You think Governor Pence is on the right track with his initiatives? Workforce
I think, yes, I do. I think the legislature is very much behind that. If you look at House Bill 1003, which was a huge accomplishment for this year, it's helping get internships into high school. It's trying to lay out pathways for kids who are not college-bound but need to be career-bound. It's looking at what high-demand, high-wage jobs are, what skills the employers are not finding out there, and trying to make sure that these kids, both in high school and then in post-secondary, are signing up for those classes so that when they really want to go into the workforce, they're going to be ready for those jobs.
Speaking of the skills gap in education, what did you think of the move to break away from Common Core? Was that a good idea, bad idea?
Common Core is a conundrum to me. From everybody I've talked to, and I went to seminars all last summer on it, I understand where people are with not liking certain aspects of it. They don't like the ties to the federal government. They think that the federal government will wind up controlling education, and I agree with them on that. I don't like that. They don't like some of the methodology in teaching the math. But again, that's methodology. That's every school can choose the methodology that they prefer. It's interesting to note that Common Core was originally based on Indiana standards because we have some of the highest standards in the country. So when you look at now going back to Indiana standards, you are going to find a lot of commonalities between Common Core and Indiana standards.
Well, Governor Pence hired an expert to look at what the state's developing to replace Common Core, and he said it looks strangely like Common Core. So I'm guessing they just went back to the standards.
I hope that they don't go totally back to them, because there's a lot of validity to what some people don't like about Common Core. And I hope that they look at those parts and take a broad perspective in allowing the teachers and administrators to be able to also have a say in what those standards are going to look like going forward. That was the one thing that I was not happy with last year when we paused Common Core. I was all for pausing it, but I didn't like the fact that they were not giving any authority to the teachers and the administrators in moving forward in what the new standards were going to look like. And I think that they work with kids, they work with standards every day, and they need to have a say in what those standards should look like.
Is it important to know that a kid who graduates, gets out of third grade in Indiana or Colorado or Utah or Kentucky, it's important that you're reasonably sure they learn the same things, reach the same level of course.
I think that there's some validity to that, yes. But I still would like for Indiana to own their own standards.
They've reached about the same place, then it would be mostly about how they got there, right? Not what the goal itself is.
I agree.
What's on your agenda for the next term? What would you like to do?
I think to keep looking at this skills gap and how we can get better training into our schools, how we can have more businesses partnering with schools so that kids can be learning not just the hard skills, but also soft skills that employers are looking for. We've got some great examples here in our own state of business partnerships. A great one right here in Fort Wayne with Fort Wayne Metals, the way that they have partnered with Ivy Tech. They even built their own training center and are now opening that up for other corporations to take advantage of so that they can make sure that the skills that they're looking for can be filled.
Is Ivy Tech something we could be making better use of, more use of, as a component of our workforce development?
I think so. I think if we truly listen to our employers, if we truly take advantage of the opportunity that they give us when they spell out what skills our workforce is lacking, we have that opportunity. I also think some of the other things that we passed this year, giving grants to adults who want to go back to school. We've got a large population of both under and unemployed adults. And what better way to be able to try to get them back into the workforce than to have them be able to go back to school.
Can I ask you about a couple of other goals that I've asked?
Sure.
Alcohol sales at State Fair.
Okay.
Just okay?
No, not just okay. I think it's good. The alcohol sales they're talking about having are locally produced. We have microbreweries in our state. We have small business wineries in our state.
Good material for Wayne, too.
Right. And to be able to highlight those, I think that the alcohol you're going to see consumed is going to be extremely limited. It's going to be centered around these, and I call them agricultural opportunities, these small producers of both wine and beer.
And I think they're going to be sold in drunken places, aren't they? They're not talking about letting people just roam around.
No. No, it'll be a separate area. I'm sure you'll have to show your ID to be able to access the area.
Guns in school parking lots. Good idea, bad idea.
People who legally carry guns are permitted to carry guns. Currently, if you want to stop by the school to pick up your student, go in and have a student-teacher conference, if you take that gun off before you leave work and put it in your car, lock it in your car so it can't even be seen, stop, pick up your child, bring them back into the car and leave,
you're breaking the law.
I don't see why I'm not sure why we don't try to change that law so that people who are law-abiding citizens, who are permitted to carry, can do so in a responsible way. I understand the fear of everybody when we're talking about guns being around our kids.
There are two sides to the argument. One's side feels that having guns anywhere near a school will increase the danger, but some of that won't get it come into school. But on the other side, of people who say some teacher with a gun in the car can run out and get it if it does show up. So, I mean, that's kind of an unresolvable debate.
The law, or the piece of legislation I had in front of me to vote on, though, did not address either of those situations. It only addressed guns being locked in cars, out of sight, on school property. So if we need to take another look at that, then we will.
Anything else you want to say?
I think that you're going to continue to see a lot of government streamlining. I think that several of the bills that we introduced this year in order to reduce government size, I think we eliminated over 400 different commissions. We eliminated a lot of things in government that we simply don't need anymore. Seeing some of that going forward.
I'd like to see more. This seemed to be what I would call a modest session. Nothing really huge. And even big ideas that were proposed kind of got cut down, like the governor's tax proposals and the they decided to do only a 5-county pilot program for early childhood education. That's not, I don't think, see that as a bad thing to you.
Well, it's, I mean, this is not a budget year.
Yeah.
So we have to be very fiscally responsible in what we're going to put out there in a year where we're not sure where our revenues are going to be going forward. They've been less than we thought they were going to be during the budget year. So I think the fiscally responsible thing to do was to have the pilot program for pre-K. I've heard a lot of people mention if we get into doing more preschool funding, then we should be looking at other things too, like lowering the mandatory age for kids to go to school. Right now it's 7. Maybe that should be 6, or maybe it should be 5. I think that there's some things that we should be looking at in that area.
Something that's always bugged me too is we have absolutely no standards for homeschooling. You can take your kid out of school and park in front of the TV all day and call it school. I guess I never understood.
I think that there are some standards. I think that if you want your child to be able to either take an ISTEP or some sort of an exam to be able to graduate, I'm thinking the standards are actually for elementary.
Yeah.
And don't quote me on this because I've not really researched it in the past 5 or 6 years, but it seemed to me that at one point there were standards for elementary, but maybe not high school. And I don't understand why there wouldn't be standards for high school.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. It's good to see you again.